Hello all, welcome to the e-Shikshana program, and this lecture is about thermal balance of human body, how human body behaves in different situations and with respect to the thermal conductivity or thermal resistivity or thermal behavior of human body. So in this presentation we are going to first study about the body's heat production and exchange with the surrounding environment. And then we'll study the thermal balance the human body has engineered to maintain balance within the body and also to the surrounding environment. So how it tries to maintain a balance, thermal balance, and similarly the behavior of human body, how it behaves like sweating or increased metabolism or different behavior of human body, and what is thermal comfort. Basically, that is what we want to achieve in any climatic situation. What is a thermal comfort? What are the different factors that are affecting this thermal comfort? And what is effective temperature or corrected effective temperature? And last, we'll try to study the bioclimatic chart, which explains how to achieve this thermal comfort by various other activities. Okay. Now today, when we see our daily life cycle has different activities, we perform day-to-day different activities, and we need rest and recovery for the human body. So it is not just physical, it is also psychological. And climate has always been putting certain effects on human body. So it can be either, as I'm saying again, it can be psychological or it can be physical also. So basically, we can't be independent of climate, and similarly, human activities differ from different climatic zones or different climatic zones. Okay, so basically, we can say that the human body is very much responding to the surrounding climate or atmosphere. So then, it has to be comfortable so that we can perform our activities and be more productive. Okay, in terms of any kind of activity, it can be sleeping or it can be even working out or performing any job or working in an office or teaching or studying. So different activities need different comfort levels. Okay, to achieve that comfort levels, we need to handle the different aspects of climate, or we can say different aspects of a physical environment, or how to control the atmosphere. Okay. So basically, so the comfort, which is again defined as the sensation of complete physical and mental well-being. Okay, so this I think we'll study in detail why it is called as a physical and as well as mental well-being. Okay, now human body is always occupied in heat production, so it is always occupied in metabolism. So metabolism is nothing but an activity where you convert food into energy, and human body is also involved in conversion of food into different muscles or different body parts and different cells and organisms. So it is also producing mass, and also it is involved in producing lot of energy. Okay. Now this energy is also in the form of heat energy. It is also in the form of different chemical energy like glucose or this thing. So basically, metabolism is running in the body, and it is exothermic. It produces lot of heat during that particular activity. Okay. Now the core body temperature, this is the average, or we can say the international average that has been taken. The core body temperature that is inside the human being, the core body temperature is 37 degrees Celsius, and on the skin it is supposed to be around 31 to 34 degrees Celsius. Now, whatever the metabolism or the inside the reactions that are happening in the human body is to maintain this particular temperature, that is core body temperature, and also to maintain the outside temperature, that is 31 or 34 degrees Celsius. Now, this is very important because the whole of idea of thermal comfort and these things, it runs, or the human body behaves, it is mainly try to maintain this particular body temperatures. Okay. Now during different activities, human body produces heat. Okay, so again it varies. So this is, you can consider an ambient temperature, And then human body at like during sleeping, it is producing a minimum of 70 watts of energy. During shifting or some moderate work, sitting or moderate work, so it is producing, let's say, 130 to 160 watts of energy. With slightly heavy work, you can say walking or moderate lifting or pushing, so there it is generating, you can see, 290 to 410 watts of energy. So this is in terms of heat energy that is being produced. So the more work we do, or more we are occupied in certain activity which requires maybe intense lifting or more energy, so then more energy and also more heat is produced. Okay, so this energy is again the product of metabolism that happens inside our body. Okay, so to produce more energy, again it is an exothermic reaction, so it is also producing a lot of heat along with the producing lot of glucose that is required to perform activities, or the energy fluids that are required for a human body to perform certain activities. So there is a lot of heat energy which is also produced for different activities. So similarly, if we are let's say in a gym, so the gym is if all the people are involved in heavy workout, then they are actually producing a lot of heat. Okay, as compared to, let's say, in a classroom where they are sitting and moderate movement or typing or writing down, so they use around 130 or 160 watts of, they are dissipating 130 or 160 watts of heat energy inside the environment, okay, inside that indoor space. Whereas if you take gym, they might be producing, or they might be producing, each person might be producing up to let's say maybe 700 to maximum of 1100 watts per person. Okay, okay, so that is a lot of heat that has been produced from the human body. Okay, so that is again dissipated into the surrounding atmosphere. It might be an enclosed space, room, so it is again collecting a lot of heat. Okay, so if it is exceeding more than 1100, then it might then the person, it depends, it is very subjective, but that person might feel the muscle burning or some kind of effects. Okay, so you can say a maximum of 1100 watts is produced during heavy workout in a particular heat, okay, in a particular human body. Now this human body is also trying to maintain equilibrium by exchanging with the surrounding environment. The sun is considered, usually considered as one of the main source of heat energy for the solar system, even for this thing. So even for the activities, even we human beings, we need exposure to sunlight we need vitamin D and other things. So when it is exposed to this thing, the direct sunlight, the human body absorbs direct sunlight. So that is absorbing heat. It is also absorbing heat by various surfaces that we touch, maybe from the ground or maybe from the furniture that we are using. So there is also always the exchange. Whichever is the hotter will radiate, whichever is a cooler will again absorb heat. Okay, so there is an exchange of heat that has been happening in whichever environment, in whichever the space he is trying to exchange with the surrounding environment. Okay, so there is always exchange that happens in different process. It can be conduction, that is with a direct physical contact, or it can be by convection, by the air flow. There might be hot air because of which the body might be gaining heat, or there might be cold air which is taking out heat from the human body. Okay, so there is again that exchange can be because of convection, because of conduction, because of the physical contact, and also maybe because of the radiation that is from the different sources. So there can be radiators or any these things. So to understand this, we can say the human body tries to gain, or it will lose the heat in various by various means. You can say metabolism is one of the areas. Metabolism is one activity in which human body produces heat. It doesn't lose heat. It always produces heat. So here we can see in this equation that is mentioned at the lower of the slide, lower portion of the slide. So metabolism, that is represented by MET, M-E-T. Metabolism, usually it is producing heat energy. Okay, it is not losing heat energy. But whereas evaporation always loses energy. We cannot gain heat energy by evaporation. So evaporation, it is always losing heat from the human body. Metabolism is always involved in gaining heat from the human body. The other functions, you can say conduction, convection, by other methods, you can say conduction, convection, or radiation. So conduction is again the heat loss or gain because of the physical contact. That might be the earth, it might be because of the furnitures, it might be because of some objects, it might be because of appliances. Yes, so it is either gaining heat or it is losing heat. Okay. Similarly, by convection, we can say it tries to maintain, that is, it either tries to gain heat, that is, maybe there is hot air that is passing through the human being. So then that body will try to gain heat, and if the body is cooler, and if the body is very hot and there is a cold breeze or cold air that is passing through them, passing around the human body, so then it will take out all the heat. So that is convection. It is either gaining heat or it is either losing heat. Radiation can be again the heat. If there is excessive heat in the human body, maybe because of lot of physical workout and this thing, so it will radiate heat into the atmosphere. So this radiation can be again heat loss or heat gain. So we can gain heat maybe because of sunlight or any other source of heat, and it can also radiate heat. If excessive heat, it can also radiate heat. Okay. So this is this process is very natural, and human body has engineered to maintain the thermal balance. Okay, so in this slide we can see the equation, that is the heat gained by metabolism and heat lost due to evaporation, and the heat you can say collective, the heat gain or loss because of conduction, convection, or radiation equates to zero. Okay. So that is, it is trying to maintain a thermal equilibrium. Okay, so that zero, we call it as, if it is zero, it means the heat gain or heat loss are both same. It is trying to maintain a thermal equilibrium, that is inside core temperature can be around 37 degrees Celsius. Okay, now this is maintained by either different this thing, conduction, convection, radiation, shivering, or metabolism activity. Or it is also heat loss, you can say it is by evaporation, radiation, convection, or conduction. Okay, so they try to either gain heat and they try to maintain the thermal balance. Okay, so we'll take some of the situations where the outside environment is having a very calm and warm air. Okay, it is very calm, that is the wind speed is given here is, let's say, 25.25 meter per second, and humidity is in between 40% to 60%, and the person is engaged into, let's say, small work or sedentary work, very minimal work. So then what happens, because the outside temperature here, it is said, let's say 18 degrees Celsius. Okay, the inner core body temperature is 36-37 degrees Celsius, and the outside temperature is 18 degrees Celsius. The skin has to maintain its temperature of around 31 to 34 degrees Celsius. Okay, so the usually the human body is hotter than the outside environment. So as he is involved in activity, so it tries to maintain this particular thermal balance by radiating or the throwing out heat outside the body. Now the heat, you can say it is radiating 45% of heat energy. It is losing heat by convection for up to 30%. And evaporation is very less, as the air is very calm. If the air is a very heavy breeze or this thing, so then we might experience a lot of evaporation. But since the air is very calm, so we experience less evaporation, and more heat energy is dissipated into the atmosphere by radiation. Okay. Now hot air let us consider another situation where hot air and considerable radiation. So there is some heat that is outside the body, and there is hot air. Okay, but here they have not mentioned the humidity value. So both, there is a heat loss that has been happening because of the convection and radiation. So heat exchange process are positive. That is, the body thermal balance may be still maintained by operation. Okay, so there is some kind of heat that is lost because of the evaporation. Sorry. Now hot air radiation and appreciable air movement. Okay, now the another situation where it is hot air and radiation, that is because of maybe sunlight or any other source, and appreciable air movement. So there is some air movement, very less air movement. Okay, so the air is hot, so then the heat can't dissipate it into the atmosphere. Very less heat can dissipate, and that is mainly because of the and that is happening because of either radiation or some amount is some amount of heat is dissipated by evaporation. Okay, because of the evaporation, so it tries to take out the heat and it tries to cool the body. Okay, because the outside environment is hot. Okay, there is hot air outside, so it tries to cool the body by evaporation. Okay, so so it tries to evaporate to a certain limit, and there is a some humidity is evaporated into the outside air, outside skin. So you can say up to 1 or 2 centimeter layer of the above the skin layer, the evaporation happens, and the water is lost to the up to 1 or 2 centimeter. So what happens after that? The air is getting saturated. That is, air is having 100% humidity. So then it will not be able to take the humidity from the skin or evaporation from the skin. Okay, so it will, the outside environment is resisting for the evaporation for this particular process. So then what happens? That causes discomfort. Usually you can say a lot of these coastal areas where the humidity is slightly less than, you can say 100% of relative humidity. So most of the times it is more than 70%. If the air is very hot and if it is very humid, then we will not be able to dissipate heat into the atmosphere. Okay, or we will not be able to cool down because metabolism activity is already running and it is generating some kind of energy for a particular activity. Okay, so then it has to radiate heat, and because of the humidity, high humidity in the atmosphere, the skin is not able to radiate heat. It will radiate heat up to a certain level, but after which the air is getting saturated. Okay, now if there is some kind of air movement, then it will take the air. The air will take, because of the convective cooling, it will take the air, the saturated air above the skin, and it will facilitate more evaporation. So that is how we try to achieve thermal comfort, or thermal comfort, or else it causes discomfort. Okay, now if the outside environment is saturated, when the air around the skin is completely saturated and there is no air movement, so then what happens? The skin will not, or the body will not be able to dissipate heat into the atmosphere. When it is not able to dissipate heat because of the high humidity and also high temperature, so that increases the temperature from core, from inside the core, or that is human body core. So we said it was 36 degrees Celsius or 37 degrees Celsius. So it will slightly increase. Okay, and it can go up to 2 or 3 degrees Celsius. So if it is going up to 41 degrees Celsius, then that person might go into coma. If it exceeds more, that if it is he will experience sunstroke, and if it exceeds more, and it might cause death. Okay, so that is why the heat, that is dissipation, is very important to the body to throw out the heat into the surrounding environment. Okay, so the condition, what we can say, the thermal comfort is the condition of mind that express satisfaction within the thermal environment. Okay, so that is why it is, we'll also try to understand different factors that affect the thermal comfort. So it is not just a physical aspect, it is also a psychological aspect regarding thermal comfort. Okay, so basically you can say there are two approaches. So one is physical approach, that is, and also a psychophysical approach, okay, physiopsychological approach to understand thermal comfort. To understand this, we can have segregate the aspects into mainly three categories. One is environmental, personal, or contributing factors. Okay, so first is environmental factors. Environmental factors are nothing but actually physical factors. Like air temperature is a physical factor. The temperature of the air, air movement. What is a air movement? What like it is a breeze, it is heavy movement or still air. So that is again a physical factor. And humidity, that is relative humidity in the air. Radiation can be from the sun, radiation can be from the any other source also. So that is nothing but again all these environmental factors are nothing but the outdoor air environment. Okay, so that is nothing but the physical characteristics of the particular place. Okay, it might be inside or outside. So these are the factors that will cause, you can say, that are the major, that play a major role in thermal comfort, achieving thermal comfort. So thermal comfort is nothing but when you feel comfortable. Okay, so to feel, so it is not just, as I said, it is not just physical, it is also psychological. Okay, and it is also very subjective from person to person. Like personal, we can categorize into the personal aspects, that is, let's say, metabolic rate. Metabolic rate is different for different person. Okay. So a person who is having higher metabolic rate will dissipate or will produce more heat energy, and a person who is having less metabolic rate will produce less heat energy. So then two people sitting in the same room might experience difference of thermal comfort because of this metabolic rate. A person who is having higher metabolic rate might be feeling hot, and a person who is having less metabolic rate might be feeling cold. Okay. And similarly, clothing, if two people are wearing different types of clothing in a same environment, in a same classroom, let's say we are sitting in a same classroom, or we are sitting in the same house, or in a particular room, or in a theater. So because of different clothing, we'll experience different thermal comforts. Yes. So one person who is having less metabolic rate might be feel more comfortable if he is wearing thick clothing. Yes. A person who is having higher metabolic rate might be comfortable in the same environment wearing a thin clothing, which has lower CLO value. Okay. So we also studied what is CLO value. That is, a person wearing thick cloth or the same will be having higher CLO value 1, 2, 3. Okay, based on the thickness. So it goes on as the thickness of the clothing increases. And similarly, different clothing will influence the thermal comfort of that particular person or to that particular setting or particular environment. Okay. Now, state of health. A person might be very healthy, or he might be having some kind of illness. Okay, he might be undergoing fever or some kind of infections or some kind of disorders. So the state of health from a person to person changes. So that is how the thermal comfort from a person to person also changes. Yes. So if he is very good health, so he might not experience this thing. But if he is very sick or ill, so he might experience either hot or cold, because he's you can say his body is not functioning properly, or it is not providing enough energy, or it is not providing enough heat production. So that is why they might experience a different in the thermal comfort. Acclimatization is also very important. A person who is living in a particular climatic zone or climatic area for a particular climate is acclimatized to that particular climate. Like a person who is living in, let's say, Arctic region, in Antarctica or polar region, so he is acclimatized to a very cold climate. Okay. And if he suddenly moved to, let's say, a very hot region or hot dry region, so he might experience more heat or more discomfort switching to a tropical climate. Okay. So it would take for a person to acclimatize to certain or a different climate for a period up to 2 months or 3 months. Okay, so to acclimatize to a particular climate. Okay, even if we are in a, let's say, winter, and if we are suddenly experiencing a climatic change, so we need so there is some kind of change that is offered or by the human body So then it requires to undergo certain changes of to adapt to a new or a different climate. Okay, so that is when they try to acclimatize to a newer climate or whatever the change in the climate. Okay, so this acclimatization is also different for different person who is been living in a particular climatic zone for a longer period. Okay, now other contributing factors are external factors, we can say. So they are nothing but food and drink. Food and drink of different climate have different practices or different calorific value, or the food might be spicy or it is not spicy or having different calorie levels. So in hot dry regions usually it is less calorie, and whereas cold region it is high calorie food. So based on the food and drink also, it will influence the food and drink we consume also influence the thermal comfort, because based on the food intake, if you are taking higher food, higher calorie food, it is producing lot of heat. Okay, so it is trying to take out lot of heat. It is also producing lot of heat. So that is how these factors will also contribute for the thermal comfort. Now body shape, he might be having very fat or thin. So that is also contributing to the, let's say, thermal comfort. Now subcutaneous fat is nothing but the fat under the layer of the skin. So that fat is also very good thermal insulator. It acts as a very good thermal insulator. So a fat person will feel more hot in a slightly warmer area, and maybe a thin, compared to a thin person or lean person, might not experience very hot. Okay, so the thermal comfort is different for a fat person and for a lean person. So subcutaneous fat, or you can say body shape, so they both contribute in a similar way towards the thermal comfort. Now age and gender is also a very important factor for the thermal comfort. People of let's say higher age groups or old age people, so they experience wheezing because they have less immune, they are less immune, and also they might be having less fat and this thing, and their body might not be able to produce lot of heat as compared to a young person. Okay, so their metabolism might be very weak, so they might experience a different thermal comfort as compared to a young. Okay, even male and female have different metabolic rates and different biology, so that is why they experience a thermal comfort in a different levels. Okay, so these are all the factors that are together contribute to, let's say, thermal comfort of a particular person to that particular climate. So there were too many factors. So then many scientists and engineers, or many people saying, they try to design or this thing, a particular scale or particular indices in which they can calculate what is the exact thermal comfort that is required, or to measure and to create certain activities. Okay, so they took off many examples. They carried out many experiments in which they came up, they had this combination of different environmental factors, different glow values, or different contributing factors to produce this scale in which they can assess what is a thermal comfort and how can we achieve a thermal comfort. So these scales or graphs are called as either thermal indices, or you can say thermal comfort scales. Okay, so we'll try to study different thermal indices and also thermal scales. So effective temperature being one of the initial idea. So this is nothing but by definition temperature of a still saturated atmosphere, which would in absence of radiation produce same effect as the atmosphere in question. Okay, so this is nothing but trying to understand, I think we'll understand with this graph, which shows which has three values. You can say dry bulb temperature, the humidity, that is again represented by this curve. You can see the relative humidity that is represented by curves. So the lower one is having curve is having 10% of humidity, relative humidity, and then 20%, 30%, and 100%. 100% humidity means it is having a saturated atmosphere. Okay, so as in the definition it says, the temperature of a still saturated atmosphere. So effective temperature of a still, that is saturated atmosphere, you can say, which is having 100% humidity. Okay. So this is nothing but again effective temperature of the saturated atmosphere when the temperature, when the humidity is 100%. So the along the x-axis, it is showing the dry bulb temperature, that is 0 degrees, 5 degrees, 10 degrees, 15, 20, 25, to up to 70 degrees. And along the y-axis, it is showing the humidity, that is absolute humidity, or you can also say, they can also show the specific humidity. Okay. So this graph, or it is called as psychrometric chart. Okay. So this psychrometric chart also explains the relation between you can say the humidity and the temperature. Okay. So we can see here, let's consider a dry bulb temperature of 35 degrees Celsius. And if I'm taking it to the humidity of 60%, okay, let's say I'm plotting somewhere here. Okay. So dry bulb temperature of 60%. So during that, the wet bulb temperature will be 30 degrees. Okay. So wet bulb temperature is always, or effective temperature, or the temperature, if I am trying to increase, let's say I am taking 35 degrees and I am taking 60% as the humidity, okay, or 60% as the humidity. And then if I increase the humidity in that particular environment, then I will be able to achieve temperature that is 30 degrees. So this explains the behavior of temperature and with the relative humidity. So as humidity increases, we all know the evaporative cooling. So to a certain extent, the temperature can be reduced by humidifying. So that is how desert coolers work. They try to humidify the hot and dry air, because of which there is a reduction in temperature. Okay. So if I'm at 35 degrees Celsius and I'm having humidity of, let's say, 60%, and I want to reduce the temperature, I can humidify and I can bring the temperature to 30 degrees Celsius. Okay. So this, with this scale also, we can try to understand how either by dehumidifying or humidifying, we can increase or reduce the temperature. Okay. Or vice versa. If I'm increasing the temperature or I'm decreasing the temperature, I can achieve different relative humidity. Okay. So so when we can also plot, let's say we can also plot thermal comfort. Here there is a rectangle, red rectangle, which is plotted, which is showing a thermal comfort. So which is having, let's say, a humidity of around less than, that is 30%. So 30% maximum humidity is around 70%. And the temperature of extreme temperature, so that say, so A, B, C, and D are the extremes of a thermal comfort. Okay, so this, they have been tested. Different people have been tested and they found out that this is a thermal comfort. So that is maximum temperature and humidity, and this is the minimum temperature and humidity. Okay. If something humidity is very less or temperature is very less, then it is achieving discomfort. So we need to bring or we need to achieve thermal comfort by either increasing the humidity. If the humidity is less, then we can increase the humidity by different various passive or mechanical modes. So then if we are increasing the humidity, then we are achieving thermal comfort. If we are having more humidity, then maybe we need to dehumidify and then achieve thermal comfort. So this is basically to understand, based on the values that we get, that is temperature and the humidity, so and how to either by increasing humidity or reducing humidity, we can achieve the comfort zone. So this can be considered as comfort zone. Now, as explained earlier, thermal comfort can be different for different person. So this can be for a person who might be experiencing thermal comfort in this range. That is, maybe he is experiencing for a higher humidity, he is experiencing 29 degrees Celsius. And from, let's say, 22 to 29 degrees Celsius when there is higher humidity. And when there is less humidity, he might be experiencing, again, 25 to, let's say, 30 degrees Celsius. Okay. So when there is less humidity of, let's say, around 30% humidity. Okay. So similarly, if it is less than this, then he need to humidify. If it is more than this, then he need to dehumidify or reduce the temperature to achieve thermal comfort. Okay, so this is nothing but it is called as psychrometric chart. Okay, trying to understand the comfort zone, thermal comfort, and the relative humidity and all, and the temperature. Okay, now one more aspect is nothing but again. Now this psychrometric chart didn't consider the wind movement. So corrected effective temperature. So this is giving only two qualities, trying to understand by either temperature or relative humidity. But later on they introduced wind or air movement also plays a major important role in providing thermal comfort. As we discussed in the situation where there is more humidity, so then the air provides thermal comfort because it is cooling, that is because of the convection, it is taking out all the hot or the heat that is dissipated into the atmosphere. Okay, so it is taking out the heat, so that is how it is trying to achieve thermal comfort. So hence you can say wind or air movement also plays a very important role in achieving thermal comfort. Hence they try to try to correct it by making it as corrected effective temperature. Okay, now this is very important chart that is also called as bioclimatic chart. Now this is a chart, we can say that it is showing different climates. Okay, it is showing very cold, you can see this is cold and hot arid, that is very dry, the humid and very hot. So this is basically showing because of there are two factors. One is along the x-axis it is showing the relative humidity, and along the y-axis it is showing the temperature. Now this might be mean temperature, it can be dry bulb temperature, it can also be globe thermometer. The temperature that we get from globe thermometer is nothing but globe temperature. Okay, so or mean radiant temperature we can say. Okay, so relative humidity, it is a combination of relative humidity and you can say temperature. So if we experience very cold in this up to let's say 50 Fahrenheit, so we are, or we can say 10 degrees Celsius, on the right it is marked in degrees Celsius and left it is marked in Fahrenheit. So up to 10 degrees Celsius, so no matter what humidity we are experiencing, the whole thing is very cold. Okay, and if we are the temperature between 10 degrees to 20 degrees, also we are feeling cold, or no matter what the humidity is. Okay, now from 20 degrees you can say the thermal comfort, or people who are comfortable, is in between 20 to 25 degrees Celsius. But again humidity with different humidity, it can be up to from 30% of relative humidity to maximum of 75% of relative humidity. Okay, so after the above this, it is either so below this or any temperature, or the you can say humidity more than this or less than that is causing discomfort. Okay, so this is a, you can say, comfort zone where people are comfortable in this particular humidity and temperature. The combination of humidity and temperature, it is giving a very good thermal comfort. Okay, so so if it is very having less humidity, so then it is considered as hot arid region. So if it is having more humidity, so then it is considered as hot humid, and more than that it is considered as very hot. Okay, so this is very hot region. So this you can also say the climatic, different climate classifications, so based on the temperature and relative humidity. Okay, so this graph is again showing, this chart is showing different behavior. Okay, so that human being feels this below this temperature very cold, and in this range he feels cold. In this range, that is combination of both relative humidity and temperature, he feels comfortable. That is nothing but again thermal comfort. So if it is less, he feels it is hot and arid, hot and dry. If it is more, then it is again the temperature is more because of high humidity, he feels it is hot and humid, and above that he feels it is very hot. Okay, so this is the general you can say the thermal comfort of a human being. Okay, now to achieve this, let's say we can take any example and we can also plot based on that. Okay, now the very important understanding of this bioclimatic chart is we can also understand what can be done to bring to achieve thermal comfort. Okay, so this is again a bioclimatic chart for men at sedentary work wearing one clothing, that is very thin clothing, in warm climate. Okay, so here in this situation, what happens? So let's say if the person is having, if there is outside temperature is around, let's say 35 or 40 degrees Celsius, and then his humidity is around 40% of relative humidity somewhere here, then because these lines indicates air movement, again two factors I think we can understand. So these lines indicates radiation and the above line indicates the air movement. Okay, so this zone indicates there is radiation that is required. Now radiation is nothing but heat energy. Okay, so if anybody is plotted or if it is located in this region or this particular, let's say having this combination of temperature and relative humidity, so then by applying certain radiation he can achieve thermal comfort or he can go into the comfort zone. If he is located somewhere here, then because of we can apply air movement. Okay, now we can see above the comfort zone there is less air movement, that is 0.1 meter per second, and if he is getting very hot then he needs more air movement, that is 0.4 meter per second, and if it is further getting heated up then he needs more air, faster air movement, that is 1 meter per second to take out all the heat, that is by convection. So this graph indicates what can be done to achieve thermal comfort. If it is less temperature and he needs he needs radiation, that radiation may be because of the sunlight or maybe because of any other appliances. It can be radiators or different types of devices or appliances which will radiate heat. Okay, so if he is getting heat then he can achieve thermal comfort. And on top, what we can see, if he is located in this hot arid or hot humid region, so then because of the air movement, if we induce air movement, then he can achieve thermal comfort. Now there are only radiation and air movement because these are two passive strategies. Okay, so when we try to understand how we can by increasing the radiation, radiation can be easily increased by letting out the sunlight. So if you are inducing getting lot of sunlight, or we are inducing lot of sunlight, then he is achieving thermal comfort. And similarly, if the person is experiencing discomfort in terms of hot, humid or hot arid, then by inducing, let's say, air movement, and by air movement can also be induced by different passive strategies. Okay, by inducing different air movement at different levels also we can achieve thermal comfort. So this bioclimatic chart, here we can see example where a person, because of radiation or because of these things, he can achieve thermal comfort. So this is nothing but here we can see, if it is very cold then the radiation is more, that is up to 800 watt per meter square, and if it is very close to thermal comfort but it is still cold, so then he needs a radiation of, let's say, 100 watt per meter square to achieve thermal comfort. So basically, to summarize, thermal comfort is nothing but it is a sensation of not just physical but also psychological, and it is very subjective to different people. And thermal comfort can be easily achieved by passive strategies, either by having radiation. If you are very cold, then you can achieve thermal comfort by giving some radiation, and if it is very cold, then you need to give wind movement, that is air movement, which will take out heat from the convection. So by that we can achieve thermal comfort. And usually you can say thermal comfort is between 22 to 25 degrees Celsius, and humidity between 30 to 70% of humidity. Okay, so this is nothing but again a comfort zone, that is usually for anybody, but people who have acclimatized to a particular climate, they feel very cold or very hot to be comfortable. Okay, so thermal comfort is very subjective, and also it can be easily achieved by the different passive strategies. Okay, so that was all about the thermal balance of human body, and also try to understand how we try to understand the human thermal comfort and how we can achieve thermal comfort. So that's all for this lecture. Thank you.